We all know someone right now in our life, or we have, who's not ethical, who's not a good person, who's winning. And you're like, I can't believe they're getting it, right? Why can't I? I'm a good person. I treat people well. I'm honest.
Most people's will to win is for sale. It's for sale.
Most people's will
is for sale.
To win is for sale.
They can be bought.
Uh-huh.
I can't be bought.
There's this governor on our lives, and it is a governor, and it's your identity. It's this internal, it's what you think you're worth. It's what you think you deserve. And the problem for good people, see, we all know someone right now in our life, or we have, who's not ethical, who's not a good person, who's winning. And you're like, I can't believe they're getting it, right? Why can't I? I'm a good person. I treat people well. I'm honest. Here's the reason why. By the way, the unethical person, eventually karma, you reap what you sow, comes home to roost. But if you're a good person, this is so important people understand this, because it took me a long time. A good person in any endeavor will only take from it what they think they deserve, what they think they're worth. In other words, if there was a pizza here, you're a good person. You don't take all 12 pieces. Right. A good person thinks there should be an equitable distribution.
Yeah. I'm a little bigger, so I might take 7 or 8. You know,
and I would arm wrestle you for it.
You would beat me.
I don't know about that. You're a moose. But long story short, what is that a good person will not take more from the table of life than they think they're worth or they think they deserve. And so you have this governor on your identity. So what happens is it's like a thermostat. Our lives get going. We start doing really well. If we're a 75-degreeer, and our life gets to 85 and 90 degrees, unconsciously we go, we don't know we're doing it. We start to cool life back down to get it back to where we're comfortable. The reverse is also true. When things start to go really bad and you're broke and you're struggling, you find a way to heat your life back up to what you think you're worth and you deserve. So the way we alter our life is, sure, we got to alter our behavior and our relationships and our circumstances, but the only way it's permanent is that we alter that governor, that thermostat, and we start to believe we're worth 85 degrees of life, 95 degrees of life, 110 degrees of life. And there's ways we can alter that.
How do we alter it?
A couple different ways. One is what you just said, is that you put yourself in circumstances that are demanding of you past what you think your capacity is, and when you succeed at them, you build a new water line. You do. You throw yourself out there past where you're comfortable, and you do an 85 degreeers behavior, and you knock it out of the park, and you go, your brain starts to believe it. Repetitiously, when you start doing that, you build a new line. Now you're 85 degrees. That's number one. The second way, though, is association. If you're around people, and whatever that endeavor is, if it's a sport you're in, or if it's a business, or your faith, or your peace, if you begin to associate with people who live in that space at a higher temperature than you, through association, you get heated up.
Yeah.
And so if you're an athlete, for example, you're a 70 degree athlete, and you start training all the time with 85 and 90 degrees, your identity through osmosis goes up. If you're a person who's trying to improve their faith in their life or their personal peace about them, you all know this, you've seen it. When you start to hang around people that are a little bit more peaceful than you or meditate a little bit more, through that association, over time, the thermostat changes in that area. And so it's both behaving in a certain way, and then your associations usually change.
Yeah, I believe that.
Most people's will to win is for sale. It's for sale.
Most people's will
is for sale.
To win is for sale.
They can be bought.
Uh-huh.
I can't be bought. So if we give you if we gave you just enough money, if there's a certain dollar amount, you'd stop working hard.
Wow,
we give you a title,
that.
You stop working hard. We give you a car or a plane or a house.
Dude,
or
that's the book, bro.
Is
that's
the book?
The book.
Is that the book? Yeah, that might be the book.
That is the book.
It's a
your will to win is for sale.
That's right. And I decided once I realized that, because I watch it happen with people in their body and their finances and their family and their faith, whatever it is, I'm not for sale. Mm-hmm. So there isn't a place you're going to buy me.
Mm.
You can't get me. There's not a stop, a place, a destination where you're going to get me to relent, to quit. I want to improve. That doesn't mean I don't struggle with my motivation from time to time.
Yeah, yeah.
Doesn't
yeah.
mean I don't get confused or down. Of course I do, but I'm not for sale.
Yeah.
You can't buy me. And you know this too. We see friends of ours, even guys in their 60s, and they sold their company for blah, blah, blah. Now they golf 9 days a week or whatever, you know? That's fun, but they're for sale. They were bought. You were bought. You were for sale.
Uh-huh.
I'm not for sale.
Everything in your life happens for you, not to you. I'm just a huge believer in that. And so my baseball dream ended. I had an injury, probably gave me a premature end to a career that would have ended anyways in hindsight, because I played with enough great players that I kind of know there was a gap in just God-given ability level, not work ethic, but I think to be the greatest, there has to be some proclivity for it and work ethic, right? And so I kind of maxed out my limited abilities. And so when I got released, I ended up moving back home with my parents. I couldn't find a job. I was depressed. I spent about a year at my parents' house. just broke in every way, financially, spiritually, mentally, physically. I remember my dad came home, my dad had just got sober, and my dad said to me, hey, I met this guy at a meeting, I got you a job. You get your ass down there tomorrow morning at 6 a.m. getting out of this house and getting a job. And I'm like, okay, I have a college degree. You know, I'm being picky for a year, watching Maury Povich reruns every day on TV and Jerry Springer. I go down there at 6 a.m. I walk in, I said, hey, my name's Eddie Mylett, I'm here for the job. They're like, what job? I remember this vividly, right? And I'm like, I don't know. They just told me you'd know. And they go, well, we have no idea who you are and we don't know what the job is. They said, do you know who's hiring you? I said, I don't remember. And they go, well, then you need to come back. And I go to the door and I go, wait a minute, his name's Tim. They're like, there's a lot of Tims. And I go, well, I know he must be an alcoholic because he was at a meeting with my dad. They go, oh, drunk Tim, we know Tim, right? And where I was a place called McKinley Home for Boys. It was a group home, a campus of group homes. All my boys were wards of the court. They were removed from their family either because their parents were incarcerated, killed, or were molesting them. And I ended up in Cottage 8. Cottage 8, I had 12 boys. They were 7 to 10 years old. And I walked through that door that morning, not even knowing what the job was, and it transformed my life. I mean, in an instant, brother. I just saw these eyes, these little boys, and they just wanted someone to love them and believe in them and care about them. And I'd have this big belief that people that go through any dysfunction in their family or abuse as a kid, I think our eyes are different. We just have these different eyes, man. And so I could connect with these guys. Mine wasn't as severe as theirs, but I knew what it was like to have that kind of anxiety and that kind of stress and that kind of pressure put on you as a little boy. And I became like their father. I was there with them on Christmas and Halloween and their birthdays, and I lived with them. And it changed my world because in that instant, I went from being this athlete who was ego, recognition, significance, gonna get rich, it's all about me. Always when you're a good athlete, you knew this growing up, it was always accolades. All of a sudden in that instant, it became about serving people, making a difference. I'm like, oh, this is what makes me happy. Oh, I was actually born to serve and help people. Crazy, no one, that never happened playing baseball. And while I worked there, 2 years into it, the financial business that I'm in came along. And I started in it part-time, and I was the rare young businessman who approached the business world from a place of service and giving and not making money. And ironically, the more I served people, the more I made a difference, the more I contributed, the more I was rewarded financially. I didn't do it for that reason, but that's what happened. So that's how I got into the business was actually, and again, everything, my dad wasn't an alcoholic. He's not at that meeting. I don't get that job. And if it wasn't an alcoholic, I wouldn't have connected with those boys. So all of that in hindsight happened for me, right? And had I met the financial business before that, I'd have flown out of it. I'd have been about ego, making money, and when that didn't happen, I'd have left. And so it all happened in the right sequence. I kept my job at McKinley, and part-time I started in the financial services industry and started to build a team of people and started to get my licenses and that transition. And I struggled like every upstart entrepreneur does.
Well, it takes like 3 to 5 years until you really get a few clients, you know.
In any business, I don't care if it's financial services, tech, dry cleaners, entrepreneurs, the first 5 years is just full of false starts. Yeah. You get it going, then you don't. You get it going, you take a step forward, you take three back. It's constant false starts. It's constantly thinking you have it going. It's constantly negotiating in your mind the price you're paying. Is it worth it? Should I quit? Should I give in? I spent the first 5 years daily contemplating quitting.
Yeah.
All the time.
Because it's not fun.
It wasn't fun. And there's just a part of you, I think, in anything you're doing when you're struggling, is this really for me? Is this my destiny? Should I be doing this? And we misread failure from some sign. You know, is this a sign I shouldn't be doing it? You know, is this a sign I am, you know, not cut out for this? Instead of looking for signs that you can win, right? And so I spent the first 5 years literally trying to find ways to quit, trying to find ways to get out, struggling. And I went broke. I lost a car. I had the water turned off in my place. I bought my first house. I ended up having it foreclosed on eventually. So I'm not that house with the unicorns that you saw, right? Or my beach place. Like, that's all the after. People don't realize that there were just years and years of grinding and struggling and worrying in the beginning. And then I made some mental changes and some shifts that altered my life then again.
I knew I wanted to be successful. I think like in most things life, they show up eventually, but maybe they don't look like the way you thought they'd look when they show up, right? So I was gonna be a baseball player. Uh-huh. From the time I was a little boy, I was gonna be a major league baseball player.
Like how young?
Oh, 4 or 5 years old, okay. Talking about that, knowing players, studying it, telling people I was gonna be one.
Looking a certain way.
Trying to be athletic, and I'm a little dude naturally, trying to build my body up and build myself up.
Little dude.
Well, I am. I mean, but I got little wrists, and I don't do Pilates, but like you do. But I do work out. But anyway, and the Pilates looks good on you. You look younger than I do, brother. So, but anyway, I did grow up wanting to be somebody, and then I got a mentor when I was really young. Mm-hmm. Hall of Fame baseball player named Rod Carew, who most of you out there would probably know, grabbed me when I was a young man and started pouring belief into me.
How young was that?
I was probably 9.
Okay.
He grabbed me, started pouring belief into me.
Why did he
saw me
you?
At a baseball camp, saw that I was a little guy, saw that I had some potential. I kind of swung like him and batted like him.
Uh-huh.
And so I spent the better part of my youth being mentored and coached one-on-one by a Hall of Fame baseball player.
Mm-hmm.
But he didn't just pour baseball tools into me. He poured belief. You're going to be somebody someday. Mm-hmm. You're going to do something great. So I had someone in my ear I respected believing in me from when I was young. Mm-hmm. I think that helped me.
Hey guys, thanks for sticking around. If you'd like more, click the videos right here. They're exactly what you need to see next. And if you're new here, hit subscribe and become a part of the Max Out community. And tell me what you think about the videos in the comments below. I read all of them every week, and I select winners that get all kinds of prizes, gear, coaching calls with me. Make a comment.